Thank you, Michel. So, yeah, Caraïbes is not only the name of the place, wonderful place where you could not go last summer. It is also the name of my project. What do we do next? Yep. So, Caraïbes, he stands for Knowledge and Representation Integration on the Brain, which sounds a bit more serious. So, what knowledge? And what brain are we talking about? So, one of the big questions in neuroscience in general is to relate brain responses that can be measured by various kinds of experiments to annotations. So, for instance, in the most general sense, behavior. So, people do actions, they use lots of mental skills to solve problems at every time. These skills that appear in the behavior can be organized into cognitive domains, cognitive concepts, as put here. And then a core hypothesis of neuroscience is that these cognitive concepts can be associated with brain domains, brain structures. And then these structures can then be observed, can be probed in neuroimaging experiments, so by observing brain activity. So, in Caraïbes, we try to describe and better understand these relationships based on the available data. So the core motivation is that people now, since people are sharing data, they realize that it's difficult to have a consistent understanding of all the data that exist. Because, you know, in neuroscience in particular, people tend to, or different labs tend to frame neuroscientific questions, each one in their own way. And so it's very complicated to have a community-level understanding of what are the relevant processes to describe, what are the main processes of cognition. And so we talk about psychological constructs, which are the concepts used by people to operationalize somehow their ideas about how the mind works, but we don't know whether these constructs, the validity of these constructs. And the same holds for brain diseases. So typically, we can characterize them through the symptoms, but maybe we don't really understand them as a pathology. And so now that we start to have lots of data available to understand cognition, to understand diseases, it's time to rethink our categories and to at least to probe our intuitions, our ideas on how the mind works against data. So let's leverage existing data and representation learning to achieve this goal. So we'll use image repositories and publication repositories that are available and identify latent factors across this data to understand these links. So now let's put that in images. I think this repeats what I did previously. So if you take all descriptions of behavior, the idea is to find some semantic entities, some links between these concepts, and to define some dimensions maybe that are relevant for description. And topic modelings, word embeddings are techniques that can be used to do that, I would say implicitly or explicitly. On the other hand, you've got this measurement of brain activity that are done in cognitive neuroscience labs with different modalities. And this can be related to brain representations using latent factor models. And we know how to do that with labeled or unlabeled data. Or they can appear as brain maps that can be directly interpreted and analyzed. So I'd like to stop 1 minute on resources because this is very key to this project. The community has started to share some of their data a few years ago. And so we have resources such as, for instance, OpenNeuro, a repository of brain imaging data sets that are now pretty big. So here we've got raw data from many different experimental studies that you can reanalyze to obtain the statistical summaries that are relevant for comparison. or people can directly upload these statistical summaries to other sites such as NeuroVolt here, which is growing very fast. And then you have other types of resources, which are the meta-analysis of the publications of the field. There are about 14,000 publications that carry cognitive concepts together with brain locations, and from which we can learn and associate brain locations with cognitive concepts. And finally, some key data sets, more traditional brain imaging data sets, some of them contributed by us, but that are now publicly available and that are very interesting because either they have lots of participants, giving a very strong statistical information, or because they are very wide in some dimension.
And I feel like he might be what I would like
this. So let's go get back to our ID. So we have this very rich data, so text, brain images, and the idea is to define statistical links between these things. So a way to put this is the concept of encoding or forward inference, in which you try to find some brain correlates of these concepts. Typically, you would like to have some, like speaking a foreign language kind of concept. Well, what is a brain correlate of that? Or you can decode, which is you give me a given brain activation image, and I try to guess what task could be possibly associated with that. So of course, these are supervised machine learning problems that are now quite easy to solve with current technology. So now let me get a bit more into the detail of the project. So the first aim is to build coordinated representations bridging psychology and brain maps. And well, there are several things to do. The first idea is to extract some latent dimensions from the data, and you can do that from images, for instance, using latent factor models or dictionary learning, that what is presented here. And we can extend current techniques. We have already worked a lot on this, and we are trying to improve them at the moment. For instance, here's a first result of our effort. We are, in these days, releasing a novel multi-scale brain atlas called DFUMO for Dictionary of Functional Modes. And we show on different experiments that this atlas outperforms current atlases based for different classification tasks. It outperforms the others not because we're more clever, or maybe, but more importantly, because we have been able to train it on much more data than usually. So essentially, these samples, the richness, the variability of current results, much better than existing tools. An interesting question is that of the dimensionality, given for some tasks, higher dimension is better. For some task, maybe a medium dimension might be a better choice, for instance, to characterize brain diseases when in the presence of very large variability. Second aspect, so here I was dealing with images. Now let's go to the aspects of the descriptions of behavior and cognitive concepts. So there are two things here. One is to find some latent structures among these concepts, co-occurrence being an obvious one. But the other important information is to see what brain locations these concepts are associated with in general, to also learn the relationships between these concepts. It turned out that, for instance, quite different concepts can be associated with similar locations, like attention, special attention, and computation. And to make this more concrete, one work that we've done very recently was to realize that so something that people like to do is to provide a certain query, like a certain cognitive concept, and see the neural correlate. The problem is that for many concepts, you have very little publications that report that concept together with brain locations. So you have a problem of data scarcity. And so you can leverage the co-occurrence of concepts to kind of develop the query into terms that are used more frequently and then provide an answer, which means, in other terms, that you accept to bias somehow your initial query, but to reduce the variance related to the amount of data that is available to answer the queries. For instance, take the term melody, which is not used very frequently. You can know that it is related to music, musical, auditory pitch, which are very frequent in neuroscientific publications. And so for all these terms, you can have reliable maps. So you can tentatively provide a brain map for a melody. And you, when you do cross-validation on the corpus, you see that these kind of maps are typically the best guess that you can make. So then now let's go further and try to associate really brain locations and semantic concepts into one big model. So there are typically two tasks that can be done. One is you provide me some locations like using brain coordinates, and I try to find what could be the cognitive context for these locations. Or you provide me some brain scan, and I try to label it in a consistent way. The point is that so far we've been, or recently actually, we've been addressing task one and task two, but relatively independently. The idea here is to share the strengths of the data that we have on the two sides by having, for instance, a network that shares some common latent representations among task one and task two, so using a joint minimization framework. So here are some types of or intermediate results that we are currently producing. So this would be for task two, where you take a brain scan and you try to associate it with relevant labels. So this is a kind of meta-analysis of all the data that we could fetch maybe 2 years ago now. And you see that we can obtain a set of what we call brain networks, set of brain regions, the activity of which is predictive of some of the occurrence of certain cognitive concepts. And so you can see that as a cognitive atlas. So the cognitive concepts are presented as word clouds, and so you can kind of build an atlas from that. And same thing based on the literature, or similar things based on the literature, you can we can take images from a repository and decode up to 50 terms that could be associated. So we can decode accurately about 50 terms, so 50 concepts that can be isolated based on the current publications. Okay, M2 of the project will be statistical inference, because it's good, of course, to be able to predict something, but it's important also to understand which features are predictive. And so we'll call that quite often interpretability. Personally, I prefer to think of it in terms of statistical inference. What guarantees can I give on the pattern that is exhibited as a support of a certain information? And so we are working on that. Actually, we have some collaborations with EMO on these questions. Recently, we've been developing aggregation approaches that provide a powerful statistical inference. And we also increasingly rely on generative approaches that were discussed in a previous talk. For instance, knockoff inference is a tool that relies heavily on generative models. And it turned out that there is a convergence of these approaches. So even in statistical inference, now we need generative models. And we will extend that possibly to nonlinear models. Another direction will be to link these representations, this knowledge, to formal reasoning. It's a joint collaboration with an ERC project, NeuroLang, from Damian Wasserman. In which we will be able to query the knowledge, the association that we learn with a domain-specific language called NeuroLang, that combines imaging data, anatomical descriptions, and ontologies. Time's up almost. So the final aim of the project will be to provide some interface, because it's meant to be used by cognitive neuroscientists at the end. So now you can stop listening to my talk and play with the interface http://neuroquery.org, in which you can provide some terms, and based on a meta-analysis of the literature, we provide a candidate brain map that could be associated with these terms, something that we have built recently in the team, but it's an interface which is available for the community. And just to conclude, so we will of course also build software. You can understand that I'm obsessed with software development. And to conclude, so a 5-year project that will provide us some new tools, some new people working on this, engineers. And it will essentially gather many contributions that we have done in the team and unify them into a common framework to go better in leveraging the existing data. Finally, I would like to thank Gaël Varocco, who provided lots of inspiration in this project. Damien Wasserman and Apo Iverinen, who also provided very important insights. Hugues Talbot, who provided excellent feedback on the proposal submitted, and the students of the team who have collaborated so far. Thank you.
Thank you. So, time for questions.
Can I ask a question, maybe, or is it?
There is one being asked already, so can you wait 1 minute?
Ah, yes, sorry.
Oui, c'est clairement, enfin, dans une perspective de long terme, je pense que c'est le cas. Il se trouve que les interfaces neurales, il me semble que les endroits où on va les voir émerger le plus facilement, c'est dans le cortex visuel, parce qu'il est très bien connu, très bien compris, qu'on a pu l'analyser très en détail, notamment sur le singe en électrophysiologie, sur l'homme. Il se trouve que le singe et l'homme se ressemblent dans ces régions-là, donc ça facilite les choses. Maintenant, la question, effectivement, tout ce qui est prothèse, etc., sortie du cortex, des cortex sensitifs primaires, donc visuels, auditifs, etc., ça devient très compliqué. Comment est-ce qu'on interagit avec la zone du langage? Encore aujourd'hui, je pense que c'est totalement obscur. Donc, il y a besoin de mettre un petit peu de l'ordre dans nos connaissances, surtout les systèmes plus haut niveau que les systèmes sensoriels et moteurs primaires, qui eux sont très bien compris. Donc on pourrait voir ça effectivement comme une perspective de très long terme, mais que nous n'adressons pas dans le cadre de ce projet.
Merci. Il y avait aussi une question en remote. Who was speaking? Can you hear me?
Maybe Max, no?
Yes, I wanted to ask a brief question, if that's okay.
Go ahead.
I'm not sure if you mentioned during your presentation, maybe this, I couldn't really hear your answer to the previous question, but I'm just wondering if you have a comment about sharing data, and especially, you know, biomedical data that I know is very, you know, sensitive, is like for privacy concerns and so on. And if there's a way to both like get some kind of data that could be studied by others, and also if you know, there's some specific tasks that you think could be maybe addressed by other, like, just general learning techniques, because I'm always interested in applying some of our tools to biomedical data, and I always run into problem with actually just getting data and even knowing what the right task is.
Yeah, maybe if you're interested in brain shape, I propose that you attend to the next talk, which will be much more focused on the brain shape aspects, I guess. So this is potentially an answer to your question. So I'm a big fan of data sharing. I think it's really essential for the neuroscientist to be able to make knowledge based on a wider view of the domain. So confronting their own data to the data of their colleagues. I think that's a very important step to make much more robust conclusions about neuroscience. So practically, it's doable. Of course, you need to anonymize the data properly. You need to, for instance, deface MRI scans, etc. So there are lots of technical behind, but we do it actually. Even under the supervision of CNIL, this is something that can be done, and this is great. So people are realizing that this is important, and so more and more data are becoming available. Even very large cohorts. There's a UK Biobank data set currently with in a couple of years 100,000 subjects that will be released. So if you want to study the viability of brains, this will be a wonderful resource. So yeah, there are good news on this side.
Okay, so thank you again. I think that we're just on time, so although I
thank
have
you.
A question I will ask you. So thanks a lot again.